but getting distracted. So that sounds like a weird statement, right? It sounds like, should I be distracted or should I not? Or should I be focused? And actually, as over the past 25 years or so, I've had the opportunity to work with dozens of startups and have seen a lot of them go through the scaling process. And one of the advantages of being an academic, being an advisor, is that you start to see patterns. You start to see patterns. You connect the dots and you come up with some generalizable framework. So one thing I will disagree with in the panel that just happened is that there is no formula. I'm here to tell you there is a formula, right? Nahi to Bollywood ki picture kaise banegi? You know, there has to be a formula. I'm overstating my case. What I will share with you is that there are patterns. And one of the really interesting things that I want to share with you, and this is my only message, and it's one simple message, and it is the paradox of scaling. And that paradox is that the very things you will do or need to do at the early stage, if you continue to do, you will die. But if you do those things early on, you will also die. So that is the interesting paradox, that you literally need to reverse your strategy as you progress from an early stage growth company to a scaling stage company. That is the paradox of scaling. And I will talk about five such shifts that you need to make. They're not even shifts, they're strategic reversals. So this is something that I observed, and by the way, I will walk you through case studies of each one of these shifts. And the common thing across all these case studies is I've been personally involved with each of these companies and I've seen them go through this process. So I can tell you there's a lot of data and observations and case studies to support this sort of paradox hypothesis, right? So let's look at what these are. I will sort of take you through five of these strategic shifts. The first thing we'll talk about is your choice of customers and markets. That as you think about your offerings, you know, this is the NASSCOM Product Conclave, but NASSCOM has a history of services. So as you go from services, and all day people have been saying services and products are two different things. Not necessarily. Services can congeal and evolve into products. But you need to go from a services to a products mindset if you want to scale, because services don't scale. Well, they scale like this. You don't like that. You want to scale like this. You want to be a Google. You don't want to be a Wipro. Okay? So, I'm just picking on, you know. Maximum gross margin is 45% for a services business. You know, you'll be very excited if you get to 45%. I've been on a board of EXL for 10 years. 40, 42%, we get really excited. You want to be Adobe with 92% gross margin. So, that's the third thing is operations. Shifting from people and individuals to actually codifying it in terms of processes and platforms. And that's where I'll share with you what Jio has been doing. Channels. You should own your destiny early on. Absolutely own your destiny. But that will kill you if you don't scale through partners later on. And in marketing, you are marketing early on. Founders, it's all about Rolodex and relationships. But in the long run, you need to build brands as proxies for relationships. So let's look at each of these shifts. Let's start with the first one. So when you start out, I met one of the startups I was working with. I said, how did you choose your first five customers? They said, these are the first people who said yes, right? So you are desperate. It's like, you go to a dance and nobody is dating you, and whoever says yes, you raise your hand. And that's perfectly okay, because what you are doing, every customer, by the way, here for a moment, I'm talking B2B customers. Let's think about, same thing applies for B2C too, but let me take B2B. You get an account, you get another account. Every customer account that you successfully close is the market speaking about product market fit. And since you're playing that game of hot, not, pin the tail on the donkey, whatever you want to call it. And then what you do is you step back. This is what happened with the Excel service. We stepped back and said, the last friend, what you have to do when you grow, and I have seen companies really spread themselves too thin. And you know who is guilty of this? It's your sales organization. You know, salespeople have told me, I've never met a revenue dollar I didn't like. Right? So then you have to start saying no. So this is like if you are going hunting, you know, initially your radar needs to be wide angle, but once you lock into a target, ignore everything else and zero in on your target. I like to say if you want to broaden your revenues, you have to narrow your markets. And remember one thing, and I'll, you know, this is something I've observed with experience now. No market is too narrow if you go deep enough. Deep. If you ever have a choice in broad versus deep, go deep. Because as you build more domain expertise, you understand the nuances of those vertical markets and those, and you'll build expertise and you build a differentiated proposition. Because nobody buys tools. Nobody buys platforms. People buy solutions. And the solution, you have to talk to them in the language and the vocabulary of their industry, and you have to speak the lingo, you have to understand the details. So that's the idea, that you know, when you, as you hit that inflection point, you have to narrow your markets, focus on targeted segments, and make fewer and bolder bets. So let me take you through a case study. So the story here is 3 years ago, Suresh Katta, the founder of and CEO of Sama Technologies, MR, you probably know him. So he came to me and he said, I'd like to take you to lunch. He took me to a really cheap place. It was an Indian buffet at Devon Street, you know. It was $6.95, all you can eat. So the price point is relevant towards the end of the story. So so I told him, what do you do, Suresh? He said, we do analytics. I said, theek hai, aage batao. He said, we have fluid analytics engine. He said, what? I said, what problems do you solve? He says, anything for anybody. And I said, what's your target market? He says, very broad. I said, run for the hills. This is a problem. So, so basically what they had was an analytics platform that on top of which you could build industry-specific solutions. But what they would do is they would go to a client and say, what's your solution? And they would build a one-off solution on top of the platform. The good news was it was 70-30, 80-20, where 80% of the functionality was hard-coded and then you had to build a layer on top. You know, so what I told him, I said, okay, now start telling me what problems you're solving for people. So he said, we have healthcare, we have insurance, we have, you know, life sciences. And I was falling asleep when he's starting to tell me about the problem because they're all very generic. Then he said, we, in the life sciences business, we do clinical operations analytics and we shorten the time to market for a launch of a new drug by 6 months to a year. I said, now you have my attention. Hold that thought. I said, stop medical devices. Biotech is too flaky and medical devices, the FDA approval process is too short. Pharma is where the money is. In pharma, ignore the small guys, not big enough to revenue-wise. Big guys have it figured, they think they have it figured out. Mid-sized pharma is your target market. So he said, this is a triple click on the addressable market. He said, you're killing me. My TAM just went down to a tenth of my, I'm now looking at a much narrower market. So listen, remember one thing, guys. Vanity TAM never helped anybody. Don't go out and say, Gartner says this is a $1 trillion market. I need 1% of it. Bullshit, show me one customer who's going to buy from you and build it ground up. That is the way to do a demand forecast. Don't ever go in front of an investor and say, I'm going to get 1% of a $10, $20 trillion market. They will laugh you out of the room. Bottom up, okay? So I said, whoa, that was all vanity TAM. You are not really addressing that market. It's not the relevant addressable market. So what they did is they narrowed, right? So they narrowed in terms of what they sold, which was only clinical operations analytics, who they sold it to was mid-market pharma company, and how they went to market. So what they did is on top of the fluid analytics engine, they built something called their LSAC, the Life Science Analytics Cloud. And now they're still selling they have the underlying platform, but now they sell the solution. Now they don't even talk about the platform. They go and talk about, I will get your drug to market faster. So fast forward 3 years. This is the email I got. I'm reproducing the exact email from Suresh. And he said, our company has made great progress since I told it the seduction of more to the wisdom of less. And he said, I'm proud to report that since you made the pivotal statement at our lunch, no field is too narrow to build a billion-dollar company. If you go deep, we have grown 50% CAGR for the past 3 years. We are again going to exceed that growth number in 2018, and we are now going to become a unicorn. I love the last line. When can I take you to lunch next? So, $6.95, not a bad ROI. Anyway, I told you the price point was relevant. So this is, so have the guts to say no. But don't say no too early because you may lock into the wrong market. So here are some diagnostic questions for the first shift. Is your revenue per market and revenue per segment decreasing, which means you're spreading yourself across? And by the way, if somebody once met me and said, I'm in 6 verticals, I said, you're horizontal. There is no such thing as being in 6 verticals, right? Any more than 3 verticals, you know, even Microsoft can't handle. So relax, right? And then, is it clear to you which markets, which vertical markets, which segments are responding more favorably to your products? Are you being recognized by competition, you know, in certain markets? And is your revenue and profit disproportionately coming from a subset of your customers and markets? At that point, throw the switch, move on. Okay, so that's the first shift. The second shift is projects to products. So many of the product companies that are here today, it is okay if you start off as a services company. It is okay if you start out with consulting engagements, with one-offs, where you, because they do two things. Services do two things for you. One, they put food on the table, right? The best way to grow is organic. So they put food on the table, and the early money you raise is the most expensive money you'll ever raise. So if you can postpone that a little bit by bootstrapping through consulting engagements, that's good. But the other thing is you're learning on the client's dime as to what problems they have, okay? But when you do this for a while, there is a concept that I love to talk about, which is DFR. You probably, some of the engineers know the DFX methodologies, design for manufacturability and so on. DFR is design for repeatability. Look for repeatability, that wait a minute, the last 10 engagements I've done, you know, they've asked me to do the same thing over and over again. And then what you want to do is to sort of codify that, productize. I like to say serviceize to learn, productize to earn, right? So what is happening here is that over time, the one-off services component is decreasing and the productized component is increasing. By the way, this is what big companies are doing today with RPA, IPA. You know, they're looking at processes and saying, I can automate this component, this component. It is nothing but taking something that's repeatable and codifying it. So what is a product? A product is a congealed service. It's a service that I've been coded. So I'll share here a case study. This is my cousin's company, Jesse's company, Axtria. And what he did, and he did this with this previous company, which was MarketRx, which he sold to Cognizant. So the MarketRx story was, they went to pharma companies, and they said, what can we do for you? They were like, help us launch this new drug. Do a marketing launch for it. What next customer, what can we do for you? Help us to structure, do the call planning for Salesforce for this particular product. So after doing 20 such engagements, they're like, you know, the two problems that people have asked us over and over again is Salesforce sizing and structuring and quota and compensation and marketing launch. So what did they do? They put a team in India for a very small company. They were a $10 million company, and they invested $5 million in product development by putting a product development team and building software platforms, which they call Sales IQ and Marketing IQ. So they built a product that gradually, over time, they built a suite of products so that now what you had was a product-enabled service. Here's the fascinating thing. Services enabled the product, but now product enables the service. So once they had built the Sales IQ and Marketing IQ, they sold to Cognizant when they were at a $40 million run rate for $175 million. You do not get a 5x multiple on sales for a consulting company. You get 2x, right? That 5x was because of the product. And that's what he's doing at Axtria now. He's got about 1,200 people, and this is much bigger now. But that's the idea, right? So productize. So that's the thing. It's okay to learn through services, but then you need to throw the switch. If you do services too long, you will max out, you'll level off. Your sales will be, you know, you'll grow linearly. But if you do it too early, you will build the wrong product for the wrong customer. Okay? So here are some diagnostic questions for the second shift. Are your gross margins leveling out? Can you start to see patterns repeating in your engagements? Do you see opportunities where you can automate product processes and convert them into products? Can you embed analytics into processes? This is embedded analytics that goes inside a process, you know. And are you finding it difficult to create a product culture? By the way, this is also true. If you're a services company, DNA is different. You'll have to carve out a team. I wrote an article in HBR a couple of years ago. Some of you might want to take a look at it. It was called Putting Products into Services, where I made the observation that embedded products that require a very different product management culture. All right, the third shift in operations. Every department in a startup company is one person deep. In fact, you need only two people to start a company. Somebody who builds stuff and somebody who sells stuff. Right? You need a technical co-founder, you need a sales slash biz dev co-founder. So as you grow, you'll find that there's a core team of people who are passionate, people who are talented, and that's where you start, right? But that doesn't scale. Once you grow the company, what you have to do is to institutionalize processes, and you have to create core processes like, you know, your sales pipeline management, you know, product development, even HR, talent management processes. Process is not a four-letter word. Because what you are able to do is take that tribal knowledge and embed it into process. If you don't do this, your systems will fall apart. You know, I went into a startup company. I said, we are having trouble growing. So I looked at, I said, what is your sales pipeline management process? They're like, what is that? Right? So I said, how do you track opportunity? They're like, it's all in people's heads or in spreadsheets. I said, for God's sake, go buy Salesforce or something like that. Start tracking your pipeline, because you don't even know who your customers are, where the opportunities are, where the leads are, what's the nurturing process, what's the closure rate, where is the leakage, and all of that stuff. So that is not something, by the way, founders don't like process. Okay, hire a number two then. Hire a COO, somebody who can do this. And it is this process that has allowed Jio to scale. I've been involved with the company since ground up. And what they have been doing, I think Jio has invented what we call a platform-based company. Whether it's the onboarding, we figured out that onboarding was going to be a problem if we are going to activate a million people a day. So we start Aadhaar-based signups. By the way, this was the eKYC. But then the government didn't allow us to do that anymore starting in January. So we had to then redo this process. And now we have digital KYC. But in either case, our onboarding capacity when we were doing the process manually was 50,000 people a day. We scaled that up to 5 million signups a day. 5 million a day. Because when you are activating 100 million, we acquired 100 million customers in 170 days. You cannot do that unless you think ahead to automating those processes. The bill and pay, the peak of 10 million payments a day, readiness of 40. Marketing arc is completely automated. We're able to deliver 600 million impressions every single day. In fact, what Mukesh Bhai has told us is that his team is zero money for customer care, zero money for marketing. Automate the damn thing. Everything has to be automated. When we had 100 million customers, we had 10,000 people in the call center. With 355 million customers, we have 3,000 people in the call center. Because 80 to 90% of our call center calls are triaged through chatbots. So that's, you know, automation is core to everything that they are doing, right? Customer care, right? The robotic customer care and so on. So the same platform approach is being applied to all of the vertical markets now. We're looking at connectivity, media, MyGeo, and then all of the verticals now. The new commerce, education, health, agriculture, government, payments. So it's the same cookie cutter platform approach that is being applied. In the morning, you saw Rakuten, they had a very interesting diagram, and I got an exactly the same diagram, which is we don't want to be a connectivity company. If you've been following the news last week, Jio deleveraged and moved the debt out. So the resultant company will be debt-free. It'll be a digital services company, and we'll bring in strategic partners. So that is because we realized that if you want to be a telecom company, you get a 6x multiple on EBITDA. If you're a digital services company, you get a 14x multiple on EBITDA. So we want to build the ecosystem like Facebook or Rakuten or Alibaba and not be a telco. The word telco is forbidden at Jio, right? So this is the connectivity business. But on top of that, we have the digital services platform, and on top of which we'll build all of the verticals. So it's a very expansive view. And this business, which is the regulated business, is what is being moved out in terms of the deleveraging, so that the digital services business is asset light and it can build all of the, because we don't want to be Netflixed or PayPal'd. You know, enough with all the OTT. The telecom companies lost this game. The AT&T and Vodafone of the world weren't able to. They built fat dumb pipes, and then Netflix and YouTube and Google sat on top of it. That's not going to happen in India. So So the diagnostic questions here are that, by the way, a very simple question I want to ask you. Do your founders have to go out and close every deal? Do you have rainmakers beyond the founders, founding team? Level 2, level 3, you can go in and close strategic deals. Even in a $100 million company I've seen, when I was at EXL, when it was a $100 million company, only Rohit and Vikram could go close deals. So I told them, guys, you will die on planes. You know, build a bench. Build a bench that can go out and close deals. So you have to really kind of make yourself obsolete. You know, push it down to the next level. Grow that talent that can particularly in the go-to-market, right? So are you running into problems with your core processes as your demands grow? Is your SG&A growing as a percentage of revenue? See, this is what I was telling you, that if you don't automate your core processes, you're going to throw people at the problem, and that's not going to scale. And your line of, you know, if your span of control is increasing, and if you've lost some key people, this is all indication that you're not growing your process capacity as you're growing your demand, right? And ultimately, that enterprise falls apart. The fourth shift is how you go to market. So when you go to market, initially own your channel, own your distribution, because you have to learn. You have to control your destiny early on. This is another quote from Mukesh Bhai. He says, we control all of our core capabilities. By the way, when we started at Jio, we had 90% COTS, commercial off-the-shelf software. We're down to 30%. It's either own source or open source. Build your own platforms, own your own capability, right? And also, you may not have off-the-shelf approaches that work for you. You have to build custom stuff yourself. When Flipkart started, they had to actually build the logistics, and because nobody was willing to deliver packages. But today, that would be nonsensical. Today, you have Udaan, and you have delivery, and you have a whole bunch of other players, and UPS. Everyone's lining up to deliver packages for you. So as you grow to scale, I say, use OPM and OPC, other people's money and other people's customers, right? How do you use other people's customers? White label yourself inside another solution. How do you, right? By the way, particularly if you're a B2B startup, I remember one startup I was working with where they built a real-time compliance monitoring solution that was sold to CFOs and chief risk officers for Fortune 500 companies. Good luck trying to get one of those customers, even an appointment with, I want to meet the chief risk officer at JP Morgan Chase. Who are you? I have three people in a startup. You won't even open the door for you, right? So what I told them, they initially hired a bunch of salespeople who were going out beating the doors. But then I said, wait a minute, guys, who has access to the auditors? Who has access to the board? It's the big four. So they went to EY, and they white labeled through EY, right? And now Ernst & Young is able to go in and say, I'm going to reduce the cost of my audit by embedding your solution in it. So look at that. Look at this, basically, to scale, you want to build the ecosystem of go-to-market partnerships that will allow you to scale. Because, and also you can pull back and over time focus on your core and let the other people do the rest. So this is another startup that I've been working with for the past 7 years, VMark. And VMark has built a smart career platform. And essentially they use NLP and machine learning to automate resumes and analysis of resumes. So they have a resume parser, on the other side they have a JD parser, a job description parser. And once you can do that, you can match. So you can actually then match people to careers. So that's the general idea. Salil and Kiran, the co-founders, you know, started this company 7 years ago. And I still remember the meeting that we had when they showed me this go-to-market slide. So they're like, acha, who do we go after? We could go B2B, we could go to business schools, we could go to liberal arts school, or we go to online schools. Oh, wait a minute, we could go to the employer, and we could go to corporate HR, we could go to the BPO factories, or we could go to the big services companies, or we could go direct to consumer, set up a resume, you know, put your resume online, and we'll analyze it. So VMark Lite, or we could, you know, put it on LinkedIn, or we can go to the vocational training people. I still remember the day the Salil, the CEO, came to me, and he said, I have this great idea from the, you know, there's an RFP from the Veterans Administration, and they want to do skills and upskilling of veterans. I said, where are you going? We are not after veterans, but he says it's a big deal. It's a big opportunity. It's a channel. You know, remember that movie, Up? Squirrel, 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 focus, right? If you keep chasing squirrels, you'll end up hungry. So, or we could white label. So when we looked at all of this, you realize that, here's an interesting fact. Before you have a single customer, you can get defocused as a startup company. So here, you know what we did? We only picked tier one and tier two business schools. That's it. Used a B2B2C model. And the idea there is I get one Stanford and I get access to 2,000 business school students and 20,000 alumni, because this value proposition also works for alumni. So today, VMOC has over 100 universities as clients, and that immediately gives you access to the critical mass of 1 million end users. So that's very, very important in choosing routes to market. We realize that by partnering with universities or using their platform of embedding ourselves there, we are able to, if we had built a B2C company like a LinkedIn, it would have cost $100 million. VMOC has built this with like $6 million. So that's, but now they're ready to scale and go B2C. So the diagnostic questions here are, how much of the addressable market can you reach with your sales force? Are there white label opportunities available to you? By the way, sometimes there are deals you don't see because you are not being invited in to look at those deals because, you know, you don't have access to those customers. So sometimes you're finding it difficult to even access customers. By the way, this is very important advice for any startup that is in the enterprise market. If you're focused on enterprise customers, 12 to 18 month sales cycles, extremely difficult to get in front of a CXO, and also you lack credibility. Because particularly if you are a mission critical software or technology company selling to an enterprise, they don't want to take the risk with you. So you have to go in with a partner. The last shift is marketing. So initially, your rainmakers are your key marketing people. Because people bet on relationships. People bet on you. When they decide to do business with you, they're betting on the founders. But your Rolodex will run out at some point. So at that point, what you need to do is, you need to use your brand. You know what is a brand? A brand is a proxy for a relationship. So a brand, when somebody knows your brand and your salesperson walks into the account, they're like, I've heard of you guys. Isn't it this what you do? It's air cover. It creates the halo. It allows it to, it warms up the account before you can go in and close the deal. But you do not need to build a brand too early. Your people are the brand early on. But when you go later on, you need to invest in building a brand because your reach will be limited. This is particularly true if you start off at the enterprise market and you want to go down to SMB, mid-market, where you don't have the reach. This is what we did at EXL. Initially, we used to do all selling was face-to-face. But then we realized that there's a mid-market and a small business segment for business process management and analytics that there's no way our salespeople could reach. So what we did at the board, this was about 5 years ago, we said, build out your thought leadership. We hired a CMO. She built out a bunch of white papers. So now if you go on EXL's website, you'll see digital intelligence and debt collections and so on. So now we're starting to get leads from small businesses and mid-market customers. That is a customer we could not reach through our traditional routes to market, right? So this is where you need thought leadership. This is where you need a CMO. This is where you need a brand. So when you're a startup company, don't make the mistake of hiring a chief marketing officer. Because you don't need marketing at that point. By the way, I met a company. They're an early stage company. They haven't got their product out yet. So they said, we hired a VP of sales. I said, what is he selling? You don't have a product. He said, no, wo mil raha tha. Siebel was going out of business. So Siebel ka VP tha. He was in the market. He was available. I said, so I went to him. I said, what are you up to? He says, here's my plan. Here's my pipeline. Here's this thing, pura client, this. I said, but where's the product? He says, I'll put that in. But I got the pipeline all organized. You know, I have nothing to put into it, but don't do that, folks. And it's costing them $250,000 a year to bring that headcount. So match your burn and your team to the stage in your company. And the same thing with marketing. So here the diagnostic questions are, what percentage of the deals in the market are you seeing or are you missing? What percentage of your prospective customers know about you when your salespeople call on them? Do you see growth potential amongst mid-market and SMB? And are you doing more hunting than farming? Right? So these are some of the diagnostic questions that you want to think about as you make the shift. So in summary, the paradox of scaling is a very simple idea that the strategies you follow early on that are necessary for your survival will be the very things that become impediments to your continuing growth. And we talked about five of these shifts. And the last thing I will say here is I hope that those diagnostic, because one of the things that when I first started writing about this, I wrote an article, people said, thank you, but when should I throw the switch? When do I know it's a transition point? That is why I came up with those diagnostic questions, because, you know, you have to watch those, and then when you start to see the market giving you signals, then you need to throw back and recognize that when you throw the switch, it's going to take some time. There's 3 to 6 months. So you need to start making these changes ahead of time. So I've seen startups make mistakes on both sides of this, that they've stayed with the early strategies too long, in which case they are not able to scale. And they've also tried to scale too quickly, use the scale strategy too early, in which case they've locked into the wrong markets or have made investments that are disproportionate to the size and the stage in their life. So that is the way I think about scaling, and, you know, good luck on your 10X journey. Thank you.